I've been in open source for more than a decade, and my latest avatar is I'm a co-founder of E2E Networks, and I head the operations there. And today what I'm going to do is like share a brief overview about haproxy and the various deployment scenarios that has been done with haproxy, and share some best practices that people have done with haproxy, and in terms of what has been scaled with this tool and so on. Basic deployment, some best practices, and one of the major grouses of today's web deployment, which is like everyone wants the shared nothing architecture, but unfortunately it's not very easy to do so. And let's look at some of the add-ons that you can do along with haproxy. So the line speed that haproxy can give is very awesome. So haproxy was one of the tools that was developed to do that 10K connections problem. Of course, it's a moot idea these days. Like everyone knows how to do 10K, but a few years back, I think like 7-8 years back, like 10K was a big target without having to do DNS load balancing and stuff like that. If you want to do single machine 10K, it's kind of considered a big challenge. And haproxy is probably the only tool that I have seen in my experience which doesn't need a restart to fix things, right? For example, people would have heard about event-driven monit restarts of a lot of tools, like for instance, your Apache, your Mongo. Everything has to be restarted at some point of time to bring it to a clean state. Haproxy is probably the only tool which hasn't had to, you don't need anything to restart haproxy, because it's like so uses so little resources, like extremely fast. The only thing that it probably needs is a lot of threads on the CPU, but other than that, like very low on like system requirements. It could probably run even on your mobile devices, and hardly any bottlenecks. If you have a well-tuned TCP stack, that's all it takes, and you can go ahead and deploy your, you can basically scale anything. And the connection management is very good in haproxy, in the sense that you could control the rate of ingress and egress to any of the front end and back end. And one of the way it helps is you can have a controlled downtime for a few of your customers rather than having a catastrophic disaster for the whole site. So what haproxy can do is like 10% of your users could be seeing indifference or like sluggish response, but it'll ensure that the rest of the 90% is kind of having a consistent response, because it can control how much each machine should serve and so on. And one of the major advantages of using haproxy is that it's able to intelligently query the state of the backends that are there. For example, if you have a tiered architecture with haproxy, where you have an haproxy and then you have a caching layer and then you have a web layer, it's very difficult to understand the state of the web layer at the proxy level. So things like a lot of people complain that we see a lot of 5.02 errors, 5.03 errors with a lot of load balancers, even in Amazon and any other load balancers. You will get a gateway timeout, you will get a service unavailable. All these are happening simply because the proxy or the load balancer isn't able to intelligently query whether the backend is up or not. It just keeps on sending dump requests on a predefined ratio, which is kind of very bad, and a lot of users start reporting all these errors. So what haproxy can do is it can do health checks at various layers, 3, 4, 5. It can do an L3 check. It can do an L4 check, find out if that port is open or not. It can even do an L5 check, load a page, and then basically determine that this application is responding, instead of just taking for granted that if a port is up, the application is up. Haproxy doesn't take it that way. And one big problem with SSL termination is that, like, if you do not have SSL termination, you cannot parse the headers of HTTP at the load balancer. So when you do a TCP kind of a load balancer, what happens is like you lose all the intelligence to parse everything, because the very ground rule of SSL says that you cannot do a deep packet inspection, or you cannot do a basically a parsing of all the headers. You can at most get L2 and L3 headers only, but with the SSL termination in haproxy itself, you could do all the intelligence with HTTP headers that you would probably do with a non-SSL connection, and you can indicate to the backend. So this, you could potentially convert any non HTTP kind of a tool into an HTTPS tool. Your backends could be like very simple Nginx. You don't have to, you're basically offloading the SSL processing to the proxy node. You don't want your application to be worried about how do I do SSL, how do I config SSL and stuff like that. Very simple deployment scenarios with a kind of a misaligned graph. So you can have an haproxy with it's the simplest representation, two web servers, and you could put a simple load balancing ratio depending upon whatever kind of box you have. And HTTP mode is the preferred mode for haproxy. That is, it understands and parses the HTTP header. And you can write a simple URL check to find out if a particular backend is responding or not. For example, if Apache runs out of threads, it will basically go into a waiting state. Or if there are too many time waits in the TCP stack, what happens is like your proxy will keep on retrying the request by a redispatch, but you won't get a response, and eventually it will time out by a 5.02 or a 5.03. So what you can do is quickly have a method of checking an URL and then determine that, okay, if this doesn't load in 2 milliseconds, I'm going to mark my application as down, that particular backend as down, and then redispatch the request to the other web servers so that the response to the customers are like much more seamless that way. X forwarding support. You can also offload keep alive to the proxy. Generally, it's the application's job to be handling keep alives, but you can offload it to the haproxy itself. It logs in Apache format. So you can do like very complicated stats with haproxy. Like for instance, if you have 5 web servers, you want to know how much how well is each of the web servers performing, and is there an error-prone web server which is giving a lot more errors than the others? You can find out all that using haproxy logs. Very simple SSL termination. You could convert any non-SSL application to an SSL service. The only support that haproxy provides in this case is like you can use an environment variable to signal to the backend Apache that this is an SSL, and then your application could use those environment variables to detect that it's SSL. Why this is required is a lot of times, for example, the Tomcat containers, the incoming request, for example, if it is HTTP, the application typically assumes that the connection is HTTP and it will give out HTTP URLs, all the relative URLs. So if you indicate by an environment flag that it is actually an SSL traffic, what your Tomcat can do is like give out all relative URLs in SSL so that your site doesn't, your browser doesn't complain that, okay, like some mixing of SSL and non-SSL is there. That kind of issues you can avoid. And this can also work in TCP mode. By TCP mode, it's like layer 4. So you can potentially use any application and do a layer 4. What you can do is put multiple MySQL masters and then have a true write scale. Instead of doing complicated things like sharding using jetpans and all those stuff, you could do a very simple master-master and then use haproxy to load balance it. Or you could have a lot of slave nodes. Like say, for example, you could have 10 slaves and then use the TCP mode to distribute traffic to them on a very simple ratio of whatever you want. And you could also imbibe health checks for to find out if one of the slaves is not responding. For example, let's say that one of the slaves has kind of locked itself up and exhausted all the max open connections that you can have. Now, if haproxy keeps on sending requests, eventually you will get, say, for instance, a communications link failure on the DB. So what you can do is build up a web check using a simple a telnet interface, which does a... you could actually emulate a ZineTD kind of a query here and basically get a success message, and then haproxy will stop sending requests to that particular box. Shared nothing architecture, why this is so important is because the moment you start talking about a shared network, even with provisioned IOPS, for instance, as Amazon, we have seen that the performance can be like really bad. So what we want to do is like have an independent web server, and anything that has to be shared can be intelligently synced using lsync. So for example, if you're running like workloads like your Magento or even your WordPress, like if you have a huge site, slash admin areas, all the uploads areas. So you could essentially trap all the post requests in haproxy, send it to the first node, and then set up an lsync mechanism, which is based on rsync, say that these folders need to be mirrored across all locations. So this shared nothing architecture actually helps in the IOPS, because if the IOPS are constrained on the web server, then that itself leads to the queues building and the processor loads like increasing drastically and so on. And you can also use haproxy to ensure that any special URLs, for example, one use case is like there was one print company and they had a special Go script kind of a script which was only working on one server. So you could write some custom rejects on haproxy. You can parse the HTTP header and say that this URL will only go to this particular server. So that way you can control where my nodes are and where my resources need to be concentrated. And the rest of them can be commodity boxes where you can just sync all your images or codes or anything using a simple lsync daemon. It's basically like uses inotify library to watch out for all the changes that happen in your file system and then intelligently syncs them by using a custom rsync command, sends it to the other boxes. So that way you're able to have all web servers in sync, and haproxy doesn't need to worry about the state of the box, whether it is like fresh or not, and it doesn't have to worry about the staleness of the content on that box. Okay. So with this, I think I'm done, and I would like to have an opportunity to thank everybody, and I'd appreciate if there are comments and any questions here.
Yeah. Hi. I mean, very interesting haproxy. I was also exploring this. So yes. So there's like a couple of questions because I also support web hosting environment in my company. So one is how does the SSL termination happen? Does it understand SNI or because we have name-based virtual hosting, so we can't have different IPs for different SSL certificates.
It doesn't support SNI.
Okay.
But it can just serve a single site.
Okay.
It doesn't support SNI for now.
Okay. And another thing was that is it possible, for example, I mean, if I automatically scale the backends number of backend servers, and you can automatically add these to haproxy and they start.
Yes. So haproxy has a graceful reload mechanism. Okay. You don't have to bring down the entire haproxy to add a node. Okay. So you could write simple bash scripts and then add the nodes and then reload the haproxy. So the corrections are cycled and then the new nodes can be seamlessly added. And there is also a SOCAT command line. You can just basically like control how the nodes are added to the system and so on.
And this is the last one.
Sure.
So the backends that I have is mainly USG and speaking and AJP.
Sure.
So does it understand something like HTTP and then redirects to USG or AJP?
Yeah, it can do that. So you can potentially parse any of the HTTP headers.
Okay.
If you are working in a HTTP mode.
Yeah.
But in TCP mode, it will just basically rely on simple metrics like port numbers and so on. But if you are into a pure HTTP mode, you can parse any of the Apache headers. The HTTP headers, and then you can decide what you want to do with this particular packet.
All right.
So it's almost like a deep packet inspection you are doing at L5.
Okay. Thanks so much.
Thanks.
Hi.
Yeah, hi.
One comment you made about it runs a lot of threads. What is that?
No, what I meant was like if you want to have a really scalable haproxy solution, you need to have a lot of CPU cores on the box. So that helps the faster responses. So haproxy doesn't need that much resources in terms of RAM or something. But if you have more number of threads, the scheduling in the CPU, in the Linux kernel, it's like much more faster responses. You can even run this on very commodity 1GB RAM kind of boxes. But if you are running a web scale haproxy, it's better to have a machine with a lot of CPU cores available to it.
So I'm worried about it taking up thousands of threads, basically. So
it doesn't take thousands of threads.
My second question I have is, how does it compare against AWS round robin DNS?
So round robin DNS is slightly more simpler than this. in the sense that the round-robin DNS takes a very simplistic view of up and down and then sends requests to that particular thing. Now, there is no connection management here in the sense that, AWS, for example, it cannot stop connections to a server once it reaches a certain limit. See, every web server has a threshold, right? Theoretically, this web server cannot take more than 1,000 connections. Now, the moment you start sending the 1,001th connection, your web server dies. Let's say for very simplistically speaking here. So that kind of facility to control the ingress to all the backends is not there. It's an evolving interface, but the ideal comparison I would say is the Elastic Load Balancer. But there are some slow cache warm-up problems there. So my colleague Ashijit here has run some huge fantasy game kind of workloads on there, and his analysis is that lot of times, when you add all the web servers and the players start hitting, there is the cache really warms up very slowly in the load balancer. But here we are not talking about a cache. We are only talking about plain connections. So the caching layers can all be offloaded and we are only bothered about load balancing here. Elastic load balancing tries to be a little bit intelligent. Tries to be a little bit more intelligent than it should be. So haproxy doesn't claim all that. It says I'm good at managing connections. Let me do that. Any other questions? Okay, yeah, thanks a lot.